Hi, welcome to Myles From Home. I'm your host, David Myles, coming to you from Fredericton, New Brunswick. Great to have you with me. I hope you're all feeling good. Hope you're all staying safe, doing well at home. I'm feeling good. I'm feeling good tonight. I went out for a ski this afternoon. I went out for cross-country ski. Beautiful Killarney Lake outside of Fredericton. It was amazing. And hopefully you're getting outside where you can. And if you're not, I hope you're staying safe and feeling good. I am certainly thrilled to have you with me. I love doing this, as you know. And tonight is going to be a great show. So please say hi. Oh, there you go. Someone's already saying hi on the comments. I can see the comments. So, you know, don't be shy. I love hearing from you. Tonight is going to be a great show. I'm very excited to have Tom Power on the show tonight. Tom Power, most of you know him. Most of you hear him probably almost every single day as the host of Q. Or perhaps before that, you heard him as the host of Deep Roots. Or on CBC, right? Anywhere on CBC. Playing music, talking about music, and now as a national, international host on Q. And he is such an amazing broadcaster and a great musician. But I'll tell you the thing that amazes me most about Tom Power is that he's always cool. He keeps it cool. He stays calm. He's always himself, down to earth, friendly, funny. I've run into Tom. I've known him for a long time. I've run into Tom in so many different situations. And he's always the same in that he's always right there with you. You know, he's down to earth. He's not looking around the room looking for more important people. He's not like that. He's chill. He's cool. And I love that about him. But what's amazing to me is that he stays cool even when he's interviewing Robert Plant or Celine Dion. I mean, most people would be freaking out, myself included. And no, you listen to Tom, he's totally chill. And the guests he's interviewing, they know that. And you can tell. That's why the interviews go so well. That's why they're so interesting to listen to, because they feel so comfortable with Tom, because Tom makes them feel comfortable, even as such a young guy. You know, he has this way with people, and he's always himself. He's not intimidated miraculously. He's not freaking out, full of anxiety. I don't know how he does it. So that's what I want to figure out. Maybe inside he is freaking out, but holy smokes, during so many of these interviews, no matter the profile of them, he's as cool as a cucumber. He's exactly the guy that I see when I'm chatting with him on the street. And I admire that so much about Tom Power. And the fact that he was willing to come on the show and join us for the next hour to talk about life, to talk about his career, to talk about broadcasting, to talk about music, to talk about whatever we want to talk about. If you want to hear anything specific, you can write right there. All right, we got people from Toronto. We got people from Squamish, BC. Yes, a couple people from the West Coast. And in Toronto, nice work. Thanks so much for being here with me. It's great having y'all here and all the way across the country. Fans of Tom everywhere, of course. Look, someone's from Ottawa. Thanks so much for joining us, Susan and Nancy Burridge from Sackville, New Brunswick. I lived in Sackville for many years. Wonderful town. So what do you think? I think we'll call up Tom and see how he's feeling. Let me do my best here. I'm going to pull up Skype, see if I can track down Mr. Tom Power. Let's see. Still waiting. Still waiting. Nothing. Hey. Oh, there he is. And you know what? I've done this so many times, and every time I'm nervous. Like, there's a moment where I'm like, not working. This is it. This is my time. It's over.
This is my time. That's very macabre, David. That's
totally.
Very macabre.
It's been a good That's run.
This is my time. I know. The button wasn't up for it, and it said you might want to turn your camera on so that David could see you, but then it obscured the very button to press. I blame technology. Hold on. Like, we were talking earlier when we did sound check. Hi, by the way. And you said, I'm going to go change is what you said. I'm just going to go change. And I said, can I wear this? And you were like, yeah, you look great. You didn't tell me you were going to have a pocket square and a well.
I mean,
like,
you should know that about me by now.
I thought home, David, home roots, David would be a little
no
more.
No such thing. Know? This is how I sleep, Tom. This is how I sleep, buddy.
I imagine you sleeping with like a nightcap.
Yeah,
you know,
pretty much. I actually totally do plaid pajamas very, very much. Other than the nightcap, it's pretty much all there.
You should get one of those candles that you hold in your hand like
yeah,
this.
Yeah, it's a Scrooge. Like, just basically totally to Scrooge it up.
You should just be full
I should Scrooge. Just be Scrooge. Not really part of my personality, but I could go there. Oh,
I guess,
man.
Yeah, I can be the ghost of Christmas future. How are you doing?
I'm doing great, Tom. I'm doing really well. How are you?
I'm not too bad. I'm here in beautiful St. John's, Newfoundland in day 12 of quarantine. Day 12 of quarantine.
Congratulations. You're almost there.
Yeah, moved home here to take care of a couple of things and all that, but it is very close to it is very strange to be here. I'm here in this beautiful quilt backdrop. I'm down here in a beautiful basement, but yeah, man, I haven't gone crazy yet, so I'm doing all right.
And you're 2 days away from being free in Newfoundland at home.
I am 2 days away from being able to see my family, and 2 days away from yeah, I'm not quite prepared for that emotion yet, to be honest.
Oh, it's going to be really special. It's going to be really, because you've been in Toronto this whole time.
I have been in Toronto. Yeah. I mean, that's where I live. I've been there. I haven't been in Newfoundland since last January.
Right.
Yeah. So, you know, it was a sort of a thing we had to do to come home, but I got to tell you, like, the closer we get to it, the more excited I am just to kind of see my family. Yeah.
Of course. You're going to love it, man. You're going to, you may never go back, dude. You may never go back. It's going to feel pretty good. It's going to feel pretty
good.
Yeah,
maybe I'll put down some more roots or something like
that.
Yeah,
you know? No, I mean, I know you love it there, and I know you try to visit whenever you can, so I'm sure it's been a big stretch.
I'm looking forward to me and Alan Doyle and Amelia Curran buying a bakery or something like that.
Yeah, there you go. I'd be there. I'd be all over that.
Yeah, no one to get a word in.
Yeah, no, it's great to have you. I appreciate you doing this. I was just saying in the intro, I always like to do an intro. I was saying in the intro, the thing that always amazes me about you is that whenever we run into each other, you're always the same. I always appreciate that about you, is that you're down to earth. You're not the kind of guy that's like looking around the room, scoping the room for the more important person, you know. But you know that world. You've seen that. Likely.
It's just that I'm always talking to the most important person when I'm talking to you, David.
Oh, you're smooth. Like, I didn't talk about how smooth you were in the intro. But honestly, I mean, what amazes me is, you know, you have this down-to-earth nature to you, which I really appreciate, and I do think it's very sincere, but that it comes across in the way you interview people as a broadcaster, and when you're interviewing people, is that something you had to work on, or like, are you hiding a real anxiety underneath when you're talking to Robert Plant, or when you're talking to Shawn Mendes, or Jerry Seinfeld? Is there any part of you that's freaking out?
Yes, I am. Yes, there is. I can be a very anxious person. And I'll say that I am anxious and terrified until the light goes on and the interview starts, and then something happens. I think you can relate to it by performing. I mean, sometimes when you have, say, if you're playing for a few thousand people, you know, you're nervous, right? You're nervous. You're pacing. You're nervous, but you're not pacing when you get out on stage. You go out on stage. And you do the thing that you know how to do. And then when you go off stage, you go like, wow, I can't believe that just happened. The equivalent for me is that I get, you know, I get so anxious and go so nervous, and I just pace, and I stress, and I pore over all the details, and I worry. And then sometimes this happened with Paul Simon. It happened with Jerry Seinfeld. It happened with Jane Fonda, that as soon as the interview was over, I burst into uncontrollable laughter. Like, I could not stop laughing, not at something that had happened in the interview, just the absurdity of my life sometimes. And with Paul, I think it was Jerry Seinfeld. So I'm from St. John's, but if you picture St. John's in your mind right now, or the people listening to this picture St. John's in their mind right now, I'm sure they picture the commercials, right? You know, the beautiful salt box houses and the water. I'm from Cowan Heights, Newfoundland, which is like the suburbs. I'm from, like, you know, basketball. Yeah, the closest thing we have to like a fishing trawler is a minivan, right?
Right.
So, like, real, real suburban, and I get a hard time from it from every Newfoundlander. But I yelled out after, I think it was after Seinfeld. I yelled out like, "What am I doing? I just talked to Jerry. I'm from Cowan Heights. Like,
right.
this doesn't make any sense. This sense at all." But something switches when I do the interview, and yeah, that all goes away for them. Sometimes, I mean, typically, you know, the first couple of questions, I'm a little nervous, and you know, but I'm. You know, I know how to ask, but I got to tell you, since COVID started, I don't know. I don't. No, I'm not that nervous anymore. Like, I think something happened. I think the first couple of years of the shows, I was really trying to prove myself, and this show has this incredible history, and you know, the show could be quite infamous. And I was so kind of terrified that of the kind of burden of the show. And then I think after the second or third year, I just started feeling more comfortable in it, you know. And I said, if this is going to work, if the show is going to work, it's going to have to work. Or if I'm going to work on the show, or if I'm not going to work on the show, it has to be because I was myself.
Right.
You know, there's nothing worse than succeeding being somebody else or failing being somebody else. So I said, I might as well just try and be myself, you know, and not try to emulate any other interview that I like. I know this is a long answer, but something I think about all the time. And, you know, I emulate another interview, try to sound like a CBC radio host. I said, I am what I am, to quote Popeye. So when I talk to someone, I know they're just people, you know,
right.
They're just people. They're people. They're just, you know, they got kids, or they got a flight they got to catch, or, you know, and then that's a whole other thing where I kind of got on that. But yeah, I usually just start with, you know, how are you? And they'll get there. You know what I mean? How are you is the great equalizer. And they'll tell me. And yeah, I thank you for noticing that. I just try
to. Well, it's remarkable. I mean, I think it's because you're a natural conversationalist. You like conversation. We like the chat. My wife's always joking now that I'm back home, like, you know, we'll be cross country skiing, and we'll run into someone, and then we'll just have a chat. You know what I mean? But the chat is like, it's like the glue that holds the world together.
We had a 5 minute sound check earlier. Me and you went for 40 minutes.
Exactly.
Because we just started
chatting. 40 minute sound check. That just because it's nice to chat, it's nice to connect. I do want to just go back just a little bit, because you said something that was really interesting. Is that since COVID, there's something's changed in terms of your nerves. I really want to talk about that, because I've been thinking about this a lot too. Is this idea that somehow with this pandemic, it's almost like everything had kind of burned to the ground, so the stakes are somehow changed. Is that how it feels for you?
I think it feels like COVID did a number on celebrity culture. There was that great, I read a great piece one day about, remember in the beginning days of COVID, there was that sort of cringy Imagine video came out where like all these celebrities in their pools and in their mansions sang John Lennon's Imagine. And to try and soothe everybody, but everyone was just kind of, I'm the opposite of a cynical person. I'm not a cynical person at all, but you didn't help but watch that and go like, come on now, boys, for God's sake, read the room, for love and honor of God, you know? And I started to feel the shared struggle, you know, the shared, you know, obviously people struggle at different levels, and this virus is impacting people in different ways. And you know, it's not linear how it's impacting people across the board. That being said, you know, there is, no one knows when this thing is going to end. Everyone's kind of terrified. Everyone's kind of worried about those close to them. And I could see that. So I found the most useful question I could ask. And it sounded a bit glib, but no matter who I talked to, I would just say, how's your pandemic going? And it didn't matter whether they were an emerging Canadian author. It didn't matter whether they were, you know, Jerry Seinfeld. Everyone kind of had the same answer. Yeah, I don't know. Pretty good. You know, hard. You know, we're getting through it anyway. You know, thank God. And I find it to be the great equalizer, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I have found it to be a great launching point to get to the human of these people.
Well, that's what I was going to say. It's so humanizing, right? It's exactly. There was a certain degree of activity pre-pandemic where there really, it was almost inhumane, and this has really humanized the experience. That people are their concerns are more real. They seem more real to a certain extent. And it, even I would say in things that I thought I was nervous about before don't seem inconsequential now.
Yeah. I'm interested to see how, I mean, like, the pandemic is awful. Do you ever have nerves about how we're going to feel at the end of all this? Like, I don't, you know, like there's sometimes I wonder like whether it'll be a bit freaky to go back to normal. But then in other times, I think it'll just last for like an hour and then we'll be right back into it.
It's totally true. I don't know. I've thought about that a ton, because I've realized that I've benefited from a lot of time away. Like I've benefited that I say yes to everything. It's my nature. I say yes. So I'm out more than I probably should be. This has actually provided a little bit of solo time and some, you know, reconstructive time that I've actually really benefited from. And I'm a little nervous actually when the doors are open. You know, it's almost like it's an excuse all the time to not do anything, is be like, well, COVID, you know? All of a sudden, there's going to be no COVID. You don't have that excuse anymore. You can't be like, hey, you want to come in? Ah, COVID, you know, can't. But I feel like I need to make sure I save that space a little bit. I'm a little nervous and not knowing how to control it, actually, without having that the COVID ejection seat.
I tell you, by one thing I hope does change is that I because my job involves so much social interaction that I do 3 to 4 interviews a day, 25 to 30 minutes per interview, right?
Oh my gosh.
And it's just so much intense talking. And oftentimes we're talking about life experiences. Oftentimes we're talking about challenging things. Oftentimes we're, you know, and you, as you know, you got to be really, really, really engaged. So sometimes in the nighttime, the last thing I wanted to do was go out to something. You know what I mean? The last thing I wanted to do was go out to a show, which is really what I should be doing. You know, and plus it's what I like to do. I mean, you know, I like to go out to concerts and I like to, you know, do all that stuff. But it was hard to get me out because I was just so exhausted. And I was saying the other day, by I hope when this is all over, I never say, nah, I'm just going to stay in and watch Netflix ever again. You
really?
Know what I mean? Like, yeah,
but
I really hope.
Do you think that you can keep it up? This is the
no.
thing. I'm...
No, I don't. I don't.
Because you must need so much to be able to do 4 interviews at that length, at that level. I mean, you must need some restorative time.
An unbelievable amount.
Right.
A lot of, like, deep solitude and just come home and go downstairs and put my face in the pillow and not talk to anybody for 30 minutes. You know what I mean? Like, yeah, a lot. And like exercise and all that kind of stuff. Mind you, God, David, I'm not shrimping, you know, exactly. You know, I'm not doing anything. It's not that hard. I'm talking to people, for God. I mean, I want to point that out. My grandfather's job was to pull oil from the harbor in St. John's by the horse up to the Newfoundland Margarine Company. So by all means, you know, I'm a very fortunate person. That being said, yes, it is. There's a lot of restorative time needed for it. And it makes me a bit antisocial, but I don't know, man.
But I mean, that's the thing. You're not antisocial by your nature. You do go out. I see at shows. You know what I mean? You also do a jam every week, don't you? I mean, when in normal times you were doing a jam, right?
Yeah, I was doing it even during the pandemic. I would go up to my friend's front porch. So playing Irish music. Yeah. And go out to my friend's front porch and distance and play music, because that was really important to me. Because as you know, I play music, and I feel like if I ever let that part of me go,
right,
I don't know, something will go missing from the job too, you know, and something will go missing from my life. That's very restorative too. So yeah, I don't know what it's going to feel like at the end of this, but I hope that I go out a bit more. I live in Toronto, where there's an amazing world-class level. I often say that every night there are 4 artists playing in Toronto that if they came to St. John's, I would never, ever, ever miss.
Oh, and I remember when I moved to Toronto, when I lived there, you know, 20 years ago. And I remember the first couple months being an obsessive music fan that I am and like you are. I found it completely overwhelming. I remember looking through now and being like, oh no, like I can't miss this. Like there are so many things happening. It just blew my mind. As you said, right? These are the kind of tours that happen very infrequently on the East Coast where we live, you know what I mean? That would come through Fredericton, St. John's once a year. There'd be a couple of these big shows, and you go to Toronto and they're like every night. It is a different thing to pace yourself.
Did you ever do that thing where just anyone was coming, like, and they were from away? Like, I remember, like, there's a band coming, they're from Montreal.
Oh, yeah.
We all better go. It didn't matter. We'd never heard of them. It didn't matter whether they were any good or not. But, you know, we'd get down there and the place would be jammed just to see something from far away.
They made the trip.
Yeah,
it was all right.
So every night in Toronto, I didn't go to see something like that. So I'm gonna try and watch that a little bit more.
Right.
I'm gonna try and get out if I can, you know?
It is an interesting thing to think about that post-pandemic world. We were talking about this even in the intro, you know, when we were doing the sound check, is this idea is like what things are gonna stay, what things are gonna go. You know what I mean? You've been interviewing people at a distance. I'm doing that, we're doing that right now, you know. Sometimes I wonder how many of these things are actually gonna keep. You know, if we haven't been thrust into a future, that a lot of it is actually going to stay the same.
It took time. At the very beginning, people were really engaged because it was new technology. When we started having Zoom interviews with people, look how cool your glass is. I got this old mug and you got a cool talk show host glass. You're like Johnny Carson.
I'll send you one.
You're like Johnny Carson and I look like Sam Roberts' homeless nephew.
Yeah, but you're like the real broadcaster. See, I had...
Sure. Look, like my real broadcasting quilt here, David. Hold on. What were we talking about there?
We were talking about being thrust into the future, the technological future.
Well, at the very beginning, when we had people coming in on Zoom, it was new technology, so people were really excited. And we would talk about, like, I still can't believe we're doing this. Look what's in your living room. Then it sort of hit this low point where I think we all had a bit of Zoom fatigue. And I started to have guests. I'm not going to say any names, but I had a couple of guests. You wouldn't hear it on the radio. But, like, kind of, like, do this. Yeah. 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 Like, check an email or, you know, like, doing something else. And then that we came out of the, and I just have to be like, my mom was a teacher. So I was like, do I got a teacher? Do I got to just be quiet? You know, what do I do here? What do I just, do I say, hey, would you mind? Anyway,
yeah,
so then you, and then it comes back up. And now we're at a point where it just feels very normal. It feels very, very natural, very normal. People have their decorum. People have how they dress. People have their backgrounds. People have their equipment. I don't know. I foresee me doing a lot more interviews like this.
And have you found, like, you know, talking about that idea of like when the conversation starts for you, that any kind of anxiety kind of disappears and you're in it, the world around you disappears. Do you find that same thing happening now over Zoom, over Skype, whatever, that happens, same thing?
Yeah, and I you know, Q is an interesting show because not many of our interviews are in person. You know, like, I'd say most of the Canadian interviews, if they're bands, an artist like yourself passing through Toronto will have you in. But for a lot of the time, especially for American artists or artists who, you know, would maybe do visual art and live elsewhere in the country, it's a lot of non-visual interviews, you know?
Right.
So, in fact, I'm actually seeing more guests than I've ever seen before. I'm making eye contact with more guests than I've ever seen before. Because we used to say, hey, if you're in Atlanta, can you go to an NPR studio Georgia?
Okay.
And I'll talk
so
to you.
So you're in the cans.
Yeah, and that's how Terry Gross does all of her incredible interviews, you know? So I never used to see most of my guests. And it's actually lovely. Like, it's lovely. It's an advantage. I love being able to sit down and make eye contact with people. I love it.
So speaking of Terry Gross, like, who are some of your favorite interviewers? Who are some of the mentors, the people you look up to?
In interviewing?
Yeah.
Terry Gross would probably be number one for me. You know?
Really?
I think she's absolutely, absolutely incredible. She has been on that show on Fresh Air since the 70s. She has a way of accessing the humanity of people in a way that I've rarely ever heard before. She's incredibly well researched, but she doesn't purport to know more than the guest. You know what I mean? She's incredibly well researched, but it doesn't take away her curiosity. I love Carol Off. Carol Off, the host of As It Happens, is tough but so empathetic and so unbelievably kind. She does like 9-10 interviews a day, and she'll be interviewing she'll be grilling the premier of Alberta and then talking to a crab fisherman, you know, in Halifax, and then talking to someone who like lost their daughter or their father, and just the unbelievable amount of heart and depth and brilliance that she has. She's really, and I've been lucky enough to count her as a friend, and I can ask her questions, and she's incredible. And I guess my third big influence is this Irish, talk show host, not incredibly well known in Canada, but his name is Tommy Tiernan, very well known as a comedian, does like, you know, Massey Hall and all that kind of stuff.
Okay.
But he does a talk show where he doesn't know the guest who it's going to be. He's on stage and said, who's my guest? And then out walks somebody.
Oh,
and his
wow.
first question has to be, who are you? And he has no idea who they're going. Sometimes he'll know them because it's Sinead O'Connor, but he's not prepared for it. And in other times, he doesn't know who they are at all.
He still doesn't know. Like, even when the so that, wow, he gets to know them.
Yeah. And
that's
I thought to myself, how would this interview go if I didn't know them at all?
Goes
through my mind at all. And because the listener generally, people listening to the show generally don't all the time. And just that freedom, that freed me up, you know, that freed me up to ask questions that some people might say are dumb questions or people might say are basic questions. And it really liberated me. So, yeah, those three, Carol Off, Terry Gross and Tommy Tiernan are kind of the big ones for me.
Did you find, like, you seem like such a natural when it comes to conversation? Are there parts of it that seem that are very natural to you, and then other parts of your job that you feel like you need to work on that are parts of your kind of process?
Yeah, I think, you know, I'm half decent. It's hard for me to get to say anything nice about myself, David. You know how it is being from where we're from.
I'm working on it.
Yeah, but I'm half decent at, you know, at talking to people and all that and carrying on and joking around. And I'm half decent at getting, you know, having the, Jesus, it's so hard for me to do this, but, you know, talking to people about, you know, introspection and vulnerability and, yeah. And kind of, you know, bigger woo-woo kind of things that I love talking to people about. You know, I'll say this. I don't have to do it very much on cue. I am in awe of people like Matt Galloway and Anna Maria Tremonti who can turn the screws to people.
Yeah,
who
right.
Who can take it. I don't have to do much of that on cue, if right. any at all. And that's how I know I'm in the right job. Because right. I don't think I'd be that good at that, or at least I'm not motivated.
Nor is it an expectation. That's an interesting observation. Nor is it an expectation of that particular program that you're doing. That's not your job to do that.
No. Yeah. And they're so amazing at it, you know, and it's so gripping and so incredible that I'm just so happy. There's been a couple of times where we've had like the Minister of Heritage on, you know, and I talk to her, and then eventually I have to ask some policy questions, and I do it. I should say, like, when we say me is a big, huge team of people who are so smart and are producing and giving me so much great research. And we're working on the questions together, you know, we're working on scripts together. So they might go, hey, buddy, I know this is outside of your comfort zone, but like, here's what we got to get. We got to get this. And okay. So when we work on it, we prepare on it, just, it takes an incredible amount of work, but it's not natural. For me,
right.
It's not natural for me to go. So the Netflix tax, how does that, you know, what do you, you know, like that's not.
So my, yeah, my what life. Does that process look like with the producers? I've always been curious because it is quite a large team. So what does it look like in the morning? You show up and you have these conversations and you develop, okay, this is where we want to get. How do we get there? What does that conversation look like?
I show up in the morning and I do the show right away. The show starts at 9 o'clock. Our show is built kind of backwards. Most people work until the show airs, but our show airs and then we work on the next day.
Okay.
So I get in the morning at around, you know, 8:30. I show up very, I don't show up too early because I work. I decide to put that time in on the other end.
Yeah.
So I show up about a half hour before I go on the air, look over everything and go in at 9 o'clock. We do the show from 9 o'clock to 10:30, whether that's pre-taped interviews, whether that's live interviews, whether that's a band coming in, whether that's a panel, whether that's a columnist. I got a big stack of paper and I'm going through it. Yeah, you know, Matt Murphy was in the Super Friends.
Yeah.
Matt is the director of Q. So I come in and he, you know, an incredible musician, incredible
he
mind.
He is also an incredible entertainer. He is such an amazing, he played guitar on one of my records. He's an amazing musician, a great singer, but he's so good on stage. It's unbelievable.
He's so funny.
Yeah, I know.
And yeah, so he's the director.
Okay.
So he's director. So he hands me a big, lot of East Coasters. Catherine Stockhausen, who photographed all the Sloan album covers and you know, was part of that whole thing with Joel and Sloan and Liz Band and Super Friends. She works on Q. Chris Trowbridge, who used to work at, what's the Dal college station? CKDU.
Yep.
He used to be the program director of CKDU. There's a lot of
East Coast. Okay. So there's a posse, an East Coast posse.
There's a posse. Yeah.
Right
so
on.
We come in and then there's the show's from 9 to 10:30. Then 10:30 to 11, we record like the coming up on cue, blah, 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 you know, the stuff that has to be done and like, you know, whatever. Plus I get like 15 minutes to have a granola bar and a cup of coffee. 11 o'clock, we have a pitch meeting. The pitch meeting lasts for about an hour. It's when the whole team gets together and people pitch stories, stuff we should cover, stuff that's happening in the news, how we could cover it, interviews that have come up, you know, ways to... 12 to 12:30, I normally get a little break to read stuff over while I'm kind of devouring lunch. And anytime between 12:30, I mean, this is back before the pandemic, but anytime between 12:30 and 3, I'm doing those interviews, 3:30, I'd say.
Yeah.
And then 3:30 until about 6:30, I'm working on the next day's interviews, be that, you know, looking at the scripts with the producers, talking to the couple of the producers about what's going on, taking meetings about, you know, general show stuff, where things are going, any other kind of stuff I got to do. And then when that's all done, 6 or 6:30, that's when you start to watch the movies and you start to read the books and you start to.
So you do actually, that is, I mean, obviously that's what most people wonder. Like, do you actually read, how do you possibly stay up on the cultural expectation of what you do?
Yeah. So
it happens at night.
I mean, at the end of the day, and literally at the end of the day, I get this big stack of materials from. I mean, this is making me nostalgic from back when I would actually get this stuff and I wouldn't print it out, you know, at home. But I get this big stack of material, which is the questions that they've kind of the roadmap that they've prepared that we've gone over that I've kind of added to and looked at, and then a big stack of what we call BG background, you know, a bunch of articles. 4 or 5 articles about this guest, right? Stuff you got to know. And if it's a movie, here's a link to the movie so you can go home and watch the If it's an album, here's a stream of the album. You go home, listen to the album. And if it's a book, if the interview would be helped by me reading the entire book, which often it is, I'm given the book like a week or two in advance, and I read the book. If not, sometimes just isolated chapters. Hey, we're only going to ask about these ones because it's more of a biography. So we're going to talk about through the lens of the book. So read these 300 pages. In here and here and here and here and here.
So you're going all the time. When you're on, when the show is on and you are the host, which is most of the time, most of the year, you're going all day.
Flat out. I love it though, man. Like, think about it. Think about what I just told you. My job is to, if you think about it, to talk, like to read, watch stuff, listen to stuff, look at stuff, and then just talk to people about it. Stuff, let's admit, I was doing with you before I ever got this job.
Right.
We'd be in some bar in St. John's, and I'd be going, so David, you know, what's that there? So where did that song come from? How many times have I asked you about Out of Love? Like, that's like, I was playing that song upstairs because I knew I was going to talk to you today. How many times have I talked to you about this? This is the stuff I was doing anyway.
It's the coolest. And so you have always been this person. High school, you were into culture, you were reading, you were into movies, music, everything.
It's a torturous thing you do, David, to make people from the East Coast talk about themselves this much. It is a torturous. You are not torturous. I'm only joking around, but it's antithetical.
It's
but
nice though. I mean, we're all curious, right? Because your job is to get this out of other people. So it's nice to hear you tell. You know, I think people. You're a young man. You're what 30, 33. There you go. So I mean, I was even thinking, like, what did high school Tom Power did? Like, what did high school Tom Power look like? Did he have a hacky sack?
He was a banjo player. I played bluegrass music.
Okay.
I was obsessed with bluegrass music.
Okay.
And I was fortunate enough when I was in high school to have a pretty supportive. I mean, I went to some when I was in elementary school and junior high. I was really not, you know, part of the in crowd. You know, like I was pretty much on my own. I was this guy who had long hair and wore like a hemp necklace.
So you did have like, a hacky sack.
Yeah, and had, you know, like bluegrass music and played hacky sack and stuff like that. Then I went to a school in St. John's called Holy Heart, which is a public school, but it's a school that has a pretty good arts program. And all of a sudden, I found myself sort of surrounded by people who were like me.
Yeah.
Not who also liked bluegrass, but people who just spoke my language.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, you know what that's like. You just feel
I know.
Like you,
yeah.
And all of a sudden, I went from being weird to like something kind of unlocked. And I had a teacher there, Mr. Etchegary, Grant Etchegary, who saw something in me. And he said, you know what? How about you MC this concert, you know, or like there's a school assembly. How about you introduce the principal?
Really?
And he gave me a lot of time to go on stage. Yeah. To go on stage and introduce this and MC this. And then, you know, I think I might have asked if I could do the announcements. And then because I wanted to be on the radio. So I did the announcements in the morning. Yeah. I read the announcement, unless there was like a serious announcement, but for the most part, I was there reading the announcements. And then, I discovered the banjo. And then through the banjo, I wanted to learn how to play the banjo. I ended up meeting a guy named Neil Rosenberg. Neil Rosenberg gave me banjo lessons. Neil Rosenberg literally wrote the book on Bluegrass, A History. And what he introduced me to was not just the music, but the why of the music. Neil was he is a folklorist, a PhD, emeritus folklorist.
And He's won a Grammy Award, hasn't he?
He has won a Grammy Award for Best Liner Notes. Yeah, for the Harry Smith.
For Liner Notes. That's the coolest Grammy. Like, so cool.
He used to let me house sit for him, and all my friends would come in and just take pictures with the Grammy. And it was everybody's Facebook picture.
And so he lives in St. John's.
He happens to live in St. John's.
So cool.
The most respected, like, academic mind in all of bluegrass music. But what he taught me when I sat down with him was, you know, he would show me how to play a tune, sure, right? He would show me how to play Roll My Sweet Baby's Arms. But then he would go like, oh, you know where that song comes from? And then he would like show me where the song came from and the why of the song. And all of a sudden I realized that like the why of art, the how is so much more interesting in some ways than the how of art. And then I realized that there was a program at Memorial in my backyard, one of the only programs in North America that has a BA in folklore. So I enrolled in that, you know, I was coming out of high school. I got into that right away. I was the only person who went into high school knowing exactly what they wanted to do.
Right.
And all of a sudden I realized there was this rich history in my own province. I wasn't into traditional music. I wasn't into sea shanties. I wasn't into accordion music or fiddle music. It was all very uncool, you know, to me. And I went to Ireland and fell in love with Irish music. I came home. My brother-in-law, Dwayne Andrews, who you know, Dwayne said, hey, you know that Irish music you love? That's here, man. That stuff's here. It's Newfoundland music. We have our own version of that. I fell deeply in love with that. And so part of my degree was I had to sit down and talk to people about where their music came from.
Okay.
Not celebrities, but I sat down and talked with fishermen, quilters, gardeners, you know, just asking questions. Where did this come from? Why did you do that? You know, I did a lot of work on food patterning, on like why in the old days people ate the same thing every single, like, you know, on Sundays they would have this, on Mondays they would have this. And what are the realities around that? You know, I did a lot of work on the why of why these songs were sung. Like, especially I did some work on why ballads as news. Like, we think of ballads as something, you know, come all ye, you know, and it's a story, but really sometimes it was about letting people know in the next community before radio that there had been a shipwreck, you know?
Right.
And then through that, I figured out how to talk. So I like to think when I talk to these people, these artists for the show, I see them the exact same as the fella who was fishing out in, you know, Morton's Harbor, you know, the fella who was out in Lamaline or something like that, you know?
Because they are. They are, basically. Yeah, they're making stuff and putting it out into the world.
Yeah, and they are. And they see themselves that way, too.
Yeah, right.
You know what I mean? Until they get a bit wild, and until it maybe starts to get to them a little bit, the fame and the industry and the commerce of it. But they are. They're just making stuff, right?
Well, I think especially over time, too, it kind of, you know, it's one thing if you're a young artist, as you said, like it can kind of go a little crazy if it's the first time in the game. But even when you're talking to like a Robert Plant or a Dolly Parton, they've been in the game. It over time you come back to realizing that it is just about making stuff.
I remember when Bob Dylan came to St. John's, I was obsessed with Bob Dylan, as we all are, right? Like, you know, I was obsessed with, you know, I knew all of his songs and I played all of his songs and I knew everything, you know, and then he was a god to me. That was important. He was a god to me. He was an otherworldly figure. And then I went up to the front of the stage in St. John's and looked at him, and he was wearing sweatpants. No disrespect to Bob Dylan, but he was wearing elastic waist pants.
Wow.
And I just had this sort of awakening moment of, yeah, he's just a guy. He's a guy from Minnesota. He's no different. And I think that, like, media and a lot of media around art had made it sound, they used terms like God, a guitar God. You know, these were the same expressions we used for Zeus. You know, these were the same expressions we used for things that seemed otherworldly. And I realized, no, we can't do that. In order for art to be accessible to everybody, everyone has to feel like they can do it, you know?
In order
for there to be a next Bob Dylan, people need to know that you can be Bob Dylan.
Yeah.
You know? And so that became, this is what I was referring to earlier, and I'll stop soon, but like, that's what became my sort of modus operandi in the interviewing, was let's just stop this icon stuff. Let's just stop all this stuff. And they're just people.
Well, I think that often in interviews too, people are talking about their celebrity rather than their work. And so by you shifting to their more human elements and their creative side, naturally, because that's your interest and that's what you believe in, they respond to it differently, right? Because you're not, you know, you're not asking them about their life as a celebrity as much as you are about what makes them, what moves them.
Yeah, some of my favorite interviews, I loved talking to Canadian artists, and I also love talking to, like, huge pop stars. Like, I love talking to, like, Katy Perry and Harry Styles, you know, and all that stuff.
Shawn
Mendes, because, you know, I don't think they ever get to do it. Our team works really hard on looking into the research and trying to find out what it is about these people that's there, you know. What's the commonality? What's the universal human element of this person? Which sounds so silly. They're just people. And I feel like when they sit down to talk to us, we sometimes, at our best, can give them an experience like they haven't had in an interview before, where we're not going to ask who they're dating. We're not going to ask, you know, what is it like to have that many people scream your name? We're not going to ask, you know, why did your band break up? I want to know what your parents did. You know, I want to know how you ended up being this way. I want to know this love song on the record. As much as you want to tell me, who are you singing about there? You know, like, if not who, then what were you feeling when you were singing that? Because maybe someone in the car will go, yeah, I felt that way before, you know?
and they themselves then open up because they haven't. I mean, I'm just laughing because it makes me think, and I don't mean this, I don't want to be disparaging to any other type of interview, but I remember I had only had experience with interviews like this, a little bit more like where they're longer form. And then with Classified, we had a hit. And for the first time I was in media worlds that weren't like that. And the interview was like, what's up? You know, and I was like, I don't know what to do with that. I don't know what to do with what's up. Like, I don't know. Or like, give me a 3 second sound bite and like make a move or something. Like, I don't know how to do that. Like, and it's not that there's a skill in it. Like, Luke was amazing. I would go to the, you know, walk the red carpet, and I felt so out of place because I wanted to have a deep intellectual conversation about my feelings. And that's not where that's going to happen. You know what I'm saying?
No, and like you said, like, I have tremendous amount of respect for people who can do that kind of thing.
It's a different speed. It's a different type of entertainment. It's totally cool. Yeah.
But very quickly, I knew I couldn't do anything like that. And I knew that, like, when the CBC hired me, I think I might have said it to him, like, boss, I'm not going to be able to, you know, like, I can kind of do what I can do, you know. And the team I work with is just incredible, incredibly brilliant people from, you know, with all kinds of different interests, with all kinds of different expertise. And my favorite thing is when they'll come to me and, you know, sure enough, I get to talk to Harry Styles and I know who Harry Styles is and I like One Direction. But, you know, I love when a producer will come to me and say, we have the person who picks the color of the color that goes out to all the design houses. And you get to talk to her about how she comes up with the color of the year. And I'm like, what? And then she sells me on it and I get excited I get interested and then I get on with her. It's like the best.
Deep nerd stuff.
There's nothing better. I mean, Peter Zosky said this thing one time that, like, if you're not interested in something, if you fake it, you'll end up getting interested in it. But also, I just think that if you're open to something, you can get interested in it. Like, everything is kind of interesting. You know?
If the person is, you know, I mean, if they have that passion, which is great because you talk with passionate people. You speak with passionate people. So
yeah,
what would be like, you know, you do these crazy 4 interviews a day. Like, is there any of these days that stand out now? Like, when you look back at the last, how many years have you been doing the show? 5 years? 6 years?
5 years.
Yeah, 5 years. So you look back at the last 5 years. Is there any particular day, like one day where you're like, what the heck just happened?
Yeah, I mean, it's hard because it's 4 interviews a day. It's thousands of interviews, you know? And
right.
But to that, I remember I came home one day and I said, I don't know who it was, but let's say I spoke to, you know, Jerry Seinfeld, and then I spoke to.
And had a moment with Jerry Seinfeld. I mean, just to throw it, you had a real joking moment. You created a joke with Jerry Seinfeld.
Yeah, that was crazy. That really did happen. Yeah, I was not expecting
that. He laughed
that.
At you.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is pretty big.
That was really wild. Yeah, I couldn't.
I was freaking out. I think I texted you. I mean, I know I texted you because I was like, what just happened, man? You just like were joking with one of the most legendary funny guys in the world.
He was wonderful. I mean, Catherine Stockhausen and I worked on that one, and he was the only guest I've ever had at that level who, when I opened the interview, before we turned the microphone on, I said, hi, hello. I'm just trying, because we couldn't see each other. He wasn't on video. And he said, hi, Tom Power. And I said, oh, this must be the publicist. I said, hi, how are you? And he said, hi, Tom, Jerry Seinfeld. Like, I'm like, yeah, I know, man. I know who you are. You know? And he was so professional, and he was so ready. And we went through, scoured through interviews, saw what worked, what didn't work, what we were comfortable with, what we weren't comfortable with. We got ready. We had the interview going, and then once I'm in there, we'll just talk.
Right.
We'll talk. Like, you're not gonna, I don't know. You're not gonna. I'm from the East Coast. You're not gonna shake me by joking around, you know. Like, and you know, you're not gonna shake me by giving me a hard time. Like when he said, "Quick question," and when I said, "Quick question for you," and he said, "What is a quick question? That's the stupidest thing I've ever heard in my life." I'm from the East Coast. Like, we give each other a hard time about everything.
You can,
all
that's right.
The time.
That's right.
I made fun of your sweater. Like, it's all you do. So once he said that, it was not like, what am I going to do? Go, hey, watch it, you know, or get thrown. I made fun of myself. I threw it back at him, you know. I gave him a hard time, you know. There's a lot of that, right? There's a lot of just being from the East Coast and being raised to not see anybody as greater than you, and you never greater than anybody else, you know.
I think about that all the time. In fact, I think that it goes right back to how I introduced the whole conversation tonight, is this idea of your humility. But part of it, and you're, you know, being down to earth in your conversations, but I also think that you couldn't get above, you know, as you say, you can't get above your raisin. You can't go back to Newfoundland and be like Mr. Fancy Pants. It won't last. You'll just get crushed.
I know. I came home one time and I said croissant instead of croissant. And I got lambasted by all of for pronouncing it correctly.
Yeah, that's right. That's too much.
Oh, my God. And I don't know what's like in New Brunswick, but in Newfoundland, all the loblaws are called Dominion.
Okay.
And I called it loblaws. And I just got destroyed. Right?
Big so city.
You can't get. I love it. You can't get away with anything. And you're absolutely right. But yeah, and you know, I'm incredibly grateful for that. You know, and sure. When they come in, it's only Buddy. It's Buddy from the TV. Yeah, he made really incredible art that changed my life. But he's a guy. He comes in. You know, we'll sit down, have a yak. And so anyway, back to what you were saying. Yeah. Like, say I'll talk to Jerry Seinfeld, and then I'll talk to Thundercat, like, you know, play on all of Kendrick's records and like incredible musician. Then I'll talk to, you know, an author in Alberta, and then I'll talk to a columnist, you know, in Toronto. And I'll come home, and I remember saying, like, I think if I had done any of those things when I was, like, I think any of those one things is someone else's best day of their life. Like, getting to meet Jerry Seinfeld is someone's story they'll tell for the rest of their life. You know, I got to meet Jerry Seinfeld. I got to talk to Jerry Seinfeld for 20 minutes is someone's pub story for 80 years, you know?
Totally.
And
it just keeps on happening.
I'm never not blown away by it.
Great.
Like, surely when I sit down with them, the nerves go away and I can talk to them, but I'm never not grateful for it. Like, it's never lost on me what I get to do for a living. It's unbelievably privileged. It's an unbelievable honor to get to do it, and to get to do it and to be able to, like, stand on the shoulders of giants who built that time slot on CBC Radio, and people,
right,
like Sheila Rogers and people like Peter Zosky, you know, and it's unbelievable to me that I get to do it. My an average day for me at CBC is someone else's best day of their,
right,
life, and like that's never lost on me.
And do you find, I find like your enthusiasm for it. I mean, I know there's a natural enthusiasm, but anything can kind of become mundane after a certain amount of. It's amazing, right? Like, but you seem to, you still have a joy for the work. Like, do you still see yourself, and do you see that joy continuing for 20, 30 years? You do.
I mean, I don't know, but I love it. Like,
awesome.
I never don't love it.
Right.
I never take it for granted. You know, I always think that I could be gone in any minute too. You know what I mean? Like, I never know. So that's just funny to say, but you know, the reason I can't think 20 or 30 years down the road, 'cause it just seems impossible. It seems impossible that, you know, I can keep doing this.
Right.
Like, it seems like the greatest scam in the world that a guy from you know, the suburbs in Newfoundland gets to keep doing this. But yeah, I never lose the enthusiasm about it, you know. Yeah, there are stressful days and there are tough days. And not all of my interviews are happy interviews. Mm-hmm. You know, you do interviews about tragedy. One function that I really value of the CBC is oftentimes we can become sort of a national wake, like a national mourning period. And we found out that Gord Downie died 5 minutes before we went live on the air. I was sitting in my office in Toronto, and my executive producer, another East Coaster from Dartmouth, Nova Scotia, Anne McKeegan, I think you know Anne, Anne
yeah,
says to
yeah,
me,
of course,
hey,
yeah.
we just got news that Gord has died, and we had to go on. And I called Alan Doyle. I called Max Kerman, just people I knew who knew him. Can you get on the phone? Right, I was breaking the news to them. Can you get on the phone right now? And they bumped us up to 2 hours. And for 2 hours, we just had artists calling in. And the team I get to work with was going crazy, trying to book everything they possibly could. Just
on the
anyone
fly.
That could call on the fly. We were live. We went on the air with no guests. And I called Alan and I called Max and I booked Alan. And while I was talking to Alan, I had Max up next. And while I was talking to Max, I didn't know who my next guest was. And they would hand me a piece of paper and go, your next guest is Sarah Harmer.
Yeah, wow.
Sarah. So like, then the day is about helping the country mourn this man. Mm-hmm. I think month two of my time on Q was Leonard Cohen's passing. You know, we were there till 3 a.m, putting together the show,
yeah,
trying to book, trying to get people who knew Leonard to come
on.
It
is one of the things that the CBC does at the highest level. that I think that show does. And I listened to Matt Galloway during, you know, he did the special during the Port-a-Pic, after the Port-a-Pic shooting in Nova Scotia. And he was so, it was so good. The tone was so good. And it actually, you realize that it serves a purpose. It serves a purpose nationally, your show, and which is pretty amazing.
At its best, it should feel like the country talking to each other. You know, at its best, it should feel like the country talking to each other. And, you know, I sometimes joke around to say that the average Tuesday show is great, you know, and I'm you know, it's lovely, and I'm happy to get to do it. And it's my great honor. Those are for me. But those big obituary shows, like those big shows where there's been a tremendous loss in Canada, even like the Alex Trebek one we did a couple of months ago, you know, that's what we're there for. And we're there to help Canadians kind of get through those moments and mourn them and introduce them to new Canadian artists and try to lead the way. But those are the heavy moments, you know, and those are the moments I feel the most grateful. The moments I feel that the most, it's not burden, but it's, you know, I feel the heaviest, you know, I feel the greatest honor of all. And yeah,
but those, you leave those work with a different feeling, I suspect.
Yeah. And you feel exhausted afterwards, uh-huh. Emotionally. Exhausted afterwards, but you feel like you did
and
something.
You've talked about anxiety. You do have there. It's not that it isn't, you know, you're joyful and you love your job, but you, like anybody else, carry stress.
Yeah. And I have panic disorder, right? So that means, you know, I suffered for a long time. I'm in some remission now. It's not that, you know, but I had panic attacks, you know, I would have horrible panic attacks.
Really?
You know? And yeah, awful, awful panic attacks. Stop me, you know, stopped in the middle of the grocery store, can't move kind of panic attacks. And I started seeing a psychotherapist, psychologist, actually, about two years before I started on Q. And if it wasn't for that work I did, man, I don't think I'd be doing the show. I wouldn't be able to do that. I'm fine now, but I actually had a panic attack in an interview one time, right, during an interview. And I have done so much work with this incredible, you know, the psychologist, and this incredible work I've done to try to get better, that it was imperceptible, you know?
Wow.
Yeah. Guillermo del Toro. It was Guillermo del Toro,
yeah,
the Oscar-winning director for The Shape of Water. Yeah. And all you'll know, the only way you'll know is when you watch the video, you'll see me kind of not really listen to the answer and just quickly ask the next question.
And that was it. That was the extent of it, though.
That was the extent of it. Yeah, I just kind of got
myself
through it.
Because you have mechanisms, you know what you're doing now. I mean, it's, yeah, isn't it amazing? This is part of what I like talking about with people who have jobs like yourself and who are in the music industry, the entertainment, public lives, is the private work that goes into a successful public life. You know what I mean? Is that at some point everybody's got to do work. Matt Mays and I talked about it, and it's, first of all, I every time it always amazes me how amazing psychologists are, how amazing these psychotherapists and psychiatrists and therapists. It's really valuable work. Like, look what it's allowed you to continue to do. You're faced with it.
It is. It's incredibly valuable work. And what a national tragedy it is that I only have access to that work because of the benefits I have because of my job. Like, what a national tragedy it is that level of care that helped me through a pretty harrowing thing. I mean, I was in the hospital.
Wow.
You know, I thought I was dying. Because your body doesn't know the difference between thinking you're having a stroke and having a stroke. Your body doesn't know the difference between thinking you're having a heart attack and having a heart attack. You know, your blood pressure still goes up.
Yeah. That's right. Yeah.
Your body still prepares for
something. The manifestations are the same.
Exactly. Your body reacts in the same way. What a national tragedy it is that I have access to that care and others don't. You know, and that's something that I've been talking about for the longest time, that, you know, the basic mental health care that I get through the CBC should be afforded to all Canadians, because look what it did for me.
Right. It's so important. That work, yeah, is so important. And for generations, we didn't do it.
Yeah. And it was hard. I didn't do it. I mean, I probably should have seen a therapist 4 or 5 years before I did. I would talk to people about this weird feeling I had, or how I was feeling a bit blue. I didn't have the language for it, David, you know?
None of us did. I mean, I honestly think this is what it means to talk about it. But I think for a lot of people, we didn't. It was the same way with me. I was like, oh, I don't know, something doesn't feel right, you know? And then all of a sudden I went to a therapist, and it was like, quite quickly, I was like, I probably should have done this a few years ago. This feels really good. Like, this is clearly helpful. Now I know. I can sense things in myself in terms of nerves and what's, you know, and so much more about myself now because I have those tools.
I try to talk about it as much as I possibly can.
I really appreciate that you do.
Because it's, I didn't, because I thought it would stop me from being me. You know, I was funny. I was good at being on stage. I was good on the fly. I was good at being quick. And I thought, oh, well, anything I do in terms of psychotherapy or psychology or therapy will deaden that somehow. You know, I think it might be my anxieties that make me me. You know, I got a job at the CBC when I was 21 years old. You know, like,
you've been in it since you were 21. Wow.
I mean, so in my third year, yeah. I got Deep Roots, my old show, when I was in my third year of university. It's unbelievable to me. It's literally unbelievable to me. Like, when I said to you earlier, you know, like, I don't know if I'm going to be doing it, because it feels like the jig's going to be up at any minute, you know? So I was always asking myself, what is happening? Why did this turn out the way it did? And the last thing I want to do is shag with it, you know? The last thing I want to do is
mess
with
it. So you felt like if even by addressing it, you were going to lose some of the magic or something. Yeah, I hear that.
It was that precarious, you know?
Yeah.
And I talked to people who still feel that way. And I can tell you, it only heightened the good parts of me, you know? It only sharpened the parts of me, you know, the good parts of me. Like, man, I wouldn't be doing Q. I wouldn't be doing Q.
Because it becomes a thing that you can carry. It becomes a part of you that you can carry rather than being overwhelming and something that you have to hide. It's the point, I think, is the other thing is that there's a sense that if it's real, then I'm not going to be able to do the things I hope to do, you know? Whereas I think if you can actually access the idea of looking at it as being a real thing, then you can move with it.
It's just incredibly normal. It's an incredibly normal thing.
Exactly.
It's unbelievably normal that everybody has. And we used to call it the blues, and we used to call it being nervous, and we used to call it, you know, it's an unbelievably normal thing to have. And again, I wish every Canadian could have that experience, because it's no fault of their own. You know what I mean?
To not have
this kind of access, yeah. You know, not to mention the intergenerational trauma felt by so many Canadians, you know, to not have, it's a tragedy that we don't have that kind of access, you know?
No, that's true. It's very true. And I'm glad that people are talking about it. I think this is the first step. It's just realizing how important that work is and how much better it can make your life.
Yeah.
And society, you know what I mean? I think you make those, as you said, intergenerational trauma, you start to address some of those mental health needs and all of a sudden we can start to move forward. But man, I really appreciate you doing this, Tom. It's just the best. You're so sweet.
Is this it? Are we done?
Well, we don't have to be, but I'm just saying, you know, it's really, I don't know. I kind of try to keep it to an hour, but you know, the nice thing about YouTube is there's no rules, dude. There's no rules.
I know.
We're free here.
I had to get used to talking to somebody again. I think for the first time, like, I've just been holed up in this rental, you know, doing interviews and stuff like that. And I hadn't talked to anybody in ages, you know, I wasn't used to it. You know, it's lovely to see you. It's lovely to,
likewise.
Geez, it makes me miss it. You know, I used to love when you would blow into Toronto and you'd drop me a line and we'd have lunch or something like that. I loved it.
It's a nice, it is really nice. I mean, I love doing this show for a number of reasons. But I love catching up with people. I mean, up till now it's been people who I know, you know what I mean? And so there's this catching up element, but it's also just, it's so nice to have a long conversation. You know what I mean? To have a real uninterrupted conversation. I actually completely, as you said, I kind of forget that there's people watching.
Yeah. I 100% forgot that there were people watching.
And commenting.
Oh, God, love them. Hi.
And they're totally
you?
Appreciating it, Tom. They're totally appreciating you.
Thanks, everybody.
Everything you do. So, yeah, it's the best, man. It's great. And I'm excited you get some new music coming out.
Dardanelle's record came out when? About a couple of months ago.
Yeah, that's
you know?
Right. And Josh,
yeah. Josh Van, yeah, who works with you and your buddy, he mixed it, did an incredible job. So yeah, I mean, I'm lucky to still be able to make music and find the CBC's grand about that, you know, giving me the time to go out and do that and took 2 weeks off in November, like about a year ago, November, to go into the studio and make a record back in St. John's of Newfoundland Music. And I'm just delighted.
It's such a wicked band too, right? It's filled with great. I mean, I love the musicians in that band.
It's a joyful thing, man. It's a joyful thing we get to do. Like, we all deeply love each other. Like, you know that kind of love that a band can have, you know, like we have a tremendous amount of love for one another. So playing music is just part of it. You know, we like to get together and hang out and have a few drinks and chat, you know, and two of the boys have youngsters now, you know, and I'm looking forward to being able to see them and stuff like that. So, and then when you get together and you work on this music and, you know, and just feeling the responsibility of this music of that's way before you, that means so much to your community, that comes from people in your community, and trying to find new ways to play it. It's the most exciting thing in the world, but I miss performing it.
Oh, that's what I was going to say. So the record has come out, but it will come. You'll actually get to perform it. And it's so weird with records that have come out during this pandemic. I put out a record too. It's like it comes out, but then it kind of doesn't until you're able to actually.
Well, like I thought, no. I'll put it out. It's not like we toured a lot anyway. Like I'll put it out. It'll feel the same. I felt good for like 7 hours.
Yeah, that's about like that is the difference. It feels great. The release feels great, but it's the extension of it.
Yeah, and we just couldn't. I didn't know how much I missed it. You know, just getting, because I don't do a lot of it. At one point we were doing like, you know, the normal 100-150 shows a year, but like now that was back when I was doing the morning show. But and I would just leave every weekend to go do gigs and then come back and then take weeks off. But yeah, you know, these days we don't do a lot. We probably do like 20, 30 shows a year, maybe, you know, if that in the first couple of years of Q. So I didn't think it would be that different. But man, I miss it. Putting out a record, learning, like I don't even, like, it's such a weird feeling to not know how to play your record. I don't really know how to play my record. Do you know what I mean?
Like, right. Well, it's going to happen. You're going to have to learn.
We haven't rehearsed it, you know, like
that starts next week, buddy.
I hope. Do you think we're going to get to some festivals this summer? Do you think?
I don't know. I'm
like you. Do you think any festivals?
I haven't thought about festivals for the summer. I haven't. I've been thinking about the fall. I haven't thought about the summer. It's hard to know. I mean, the East Coast, we might be different in different regions. You know what I mean? I mean, it would be amazing, but I've just taken it as it goes. It's so much up and down and everything else. Now I'm just kind of like, I'm a day by day guy. If it happens, wonderful. I'm not counting on it, but.
Did you do any Atlantic Bubble shows?
I did. Yep. I did a couple. I played in New Glasgow. I played down in Berwick. I did a show here in Fredericton at the Playhouse. That was for the Jazz Festival volunteers. And I have some next month, but I don't know. We don't know exactly what's going to happen, but I have quite a few actually next month, St. John and Fredericton, and some cool shows, but we'll just see where we're at.
That's beautiful. I would love to get to see it. You know, I'm fortunate enough in Toronto to still be able to, you know, even during the, you know, when things got a bit lighter in the summertime, we were still able to go outside to like patios and play music and play sessions and stuff like that. And, you know, and I can't imagine what it's like to not be able to do it. You know,
I think that this is, it kind of goes back, right? We realize all these little things that we took for granted, just shows aside, just the magic of sitting in a room and playing together, sharing songs, hearing an instrument right beside you, leaving a break in a song and having a guitar player take a solo. Not you take the solo. Let's, you know, where someone else just blows your mind that's right beside you. That is so special and magical, and you can kind of get used to it, and then it's gone, and it's special when it happens.
I think even, I was just saying, you know, talking to you reminds me of just how grateful I am. You know, when I was in growing up in Newfoundland as a musician, I thought we were just our own little thing, you know, in Newfoundland, you know, and like, oh, we were so different than sort of the rest of the world, and we were Newfoundland musicians. And then, you know, when I started going to the ECMAs and I met folks like you and Joel and Rose and Danny Ledwell and Jane Grant, you know, and the Coig crowd, like, I felt such a part of that East Coast thing. You know what I mean? Like, I felt a deep part of being an East Coast musician and someone from the arts in the East Coast. And even though I moved to Toronto, that's never gone away. Like, what a lovely little community is built out of that ECMA.
It truly is. It truly is. And I feel that way every time I go back to the ECMAs. I've been, most of it's social. Most of it's just about seeing the community that exists. And I, you know, I'm in Fredericton and I still talk to so many of those people all the time. I talked to Ludica last week. I, you know, and now Afy Bahamas is here on the East Coast. He's now part of the scene, you know, and Joel.
Yeah, but he's got to go to an ECMA until like 6 a.m. in order to get the full card.
Yeah, that's right.
You know what I mean? Like,
yeah. He's got to hang out with Flo Sampson
really
until 4 a.m.
if he hasn't been in a hotel suite with Gordy Sampson's mom.
That's
playing
Flo,
piano.
Man. That's what I'm saying. Flo Sampson. That's the rite of passage. If you haven't done that, you're not part of the scene yet, man. That is the true initiation.
But isn't that just great, man? Like, no matter what, no matter where life takes us, we can always rely on that. You know what I mean? Like, any of you guys, we go to each other's shows. We talk to each other. You know, it's never gone away. What a beautiful community built by people like Sherry Jones and people like Mickey Quaze. And you know, like, built by a couple of people in the 90s.
Who put their time in and do it because they love it. Because it's not... I mean, especially now, these people are still working on it. You know what I mean? They're still working in the industry. They're still going at it. And frankly, if there was not much money in it before, there's really not much money in it this year. You know what I'm saying? And they're still in it, working, keeping that community going. No, I'm so grateful. And I get more grateful as I get older and look at the actual volunteer hours and these people, just how much time is spent just so we get to exist in it. It's so special.
Yeah. It's a lovely thing. And I got to go to the ECMAs for the first time in a few years, a couple of years ago. I think we did Q. From Halifax. And you're right. It was like putting on an old sweater, man. I just sat at the bar in the hotel and chatted with whoever.
And just looked for the most important person in the room. Just like...
I was talking to you and looking around. Is that Wayne? Okay, that's Wayne O'Connor. Never mind. Excuse me, I gotta go. I gotta talk to Wayne for a second.
Gotta talk to Wayne for sure.
Yeah, Wayne sort of takes all of your. But you know what I mean, man. Like I just love it. I miss it so much. So maybe one of my things I'm most looking forward to. I tell you, I'm not gonna miss the ECMAs this year. I'm not gonna miss them. When we come back to the when everything gets back to normal.
That's the best.
We'll be at the bar together, or we'll be with Flo until 7 in the morning.
We definitely will be, man. This is awesome, dude. Thank you so much for doing this, Tom, for taking the time.
Oh God, David, this is so much fun, man. This is a joy for me. Thanks for having me. I know, as an interviewer, I never get to talk. Strangely,
I figured that's why I was excited to do this.
So it was funny. It was like some of the questions you were asking me earlier about interviewing. I hadn't thought about them. I hadn't really articulated. I thought about it myself, but I hadn't really articulated. So thanks for having me on.
Oh, well, you articulated it beautifully, and I knew you would. You're a smart guy. You're a great guy. Thank you so much for this. And
get
have fun in Newfoundland, man. Enjoy your time at home.
Well, I will. You know, I'm grateful to be here, and I hope
you're gonna
to see you
love
soon,
it. But... You're gonna love it.
All right, take care of yourself, man.
All right, buddy. Peace.
Do I log off now? Is that what I do?
Yeah, that's all good.
Okay. See you, buddy.
Thanks,
bye, guys.
Man. See you. Bye. Thanks. All right. Thanks, everybody. I hope you enjoyed that conversation. Thank you so much to Tom Power. Thanks, everybody who's been watching the show. I had a great time. Always do. I love these conversations. We're going to do it again next month. We're trying to do this every month. Next month, I am also releasing a podcast. We're going to put out these conversations in podcast form, plus a few other conversations I've had in my studio pre-pandemic. And also some conversations that I'm now doing, not live on YouTube, but having through the blessing of technology. So there'll be a podcast coming out, also called Myles From Home, real soon. Next month, we'll do another YouTube live. In the meantime, thank you so much. Take care of yourselves. Peace.